That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
It has been nearly four decades since humans first walked on the moon. In the years since that first Apollo mission, our exploration of space has continued to advance, providing us with an ever-expanding perspective of our place in the solar system and beyond. And ASU researchers are at the forefront of this effort.
To me, there are two great motivations for going to space. And one, probably the primary motivation to me, is to understand whether or not we're alone in the universe. At the same time, our survival as a species on this planet depends on our understanding how this planet evolved. And part of that question can be answered by the research that we do on this planet, but there are parts of it that we cannot answer unless we look outside our home world.
Because the Earth is such a dynamic place, it has evolved considerably over the billions of years since its creation, and in the process has left few clues to help unravel the mystery of its origins.
On the Earth, all the old rocks are gone. I mean, they've been eroded and melted, and so finding old rocks on the Earth is almost impossible, but early in the history of the Earth, there were large impacts that made big holes, and they threw stuff into the air, and some of that stuff landed on the moon. And it's been sitting there for a very long time, just sort of, you know, minding its own business. The moon doesn't have water, and it doesn't have plate tectonics, and so those rocks just sit there. And so we've talked about building one of these little instruments that can tell what the rocks are made of, and sending it to the moon, drive around, look at literally millions of rocks, and maybe, if we're lucky, find that Earth rock sitting there ready to tell us a unknown story of what the Earth was like 4.5 billion years ago.
At one time, Christensen admits that he would have considered such an idea science fiction. But in the decades he and his colleagues have been exploring another of Earth's neighbors, advances in technology have allowed the implausible to become the possible.
The first instrument I sent to Mars was an instrument called TESS. It's an infrared spectrometer, measures infrared light. It went into orbit, and it mapped Mars for about 10 years. TESS gave us the very first mineral maps of Mars. They gave us a 10-year record of the atmosphere, its weather. Mars has weather. They mapped the polar caps and the ices, and we found, again, this mineral hematite that started pointing us down a direction of water in a very local place on Mars. We followed that up with a camera called THEMIS, which takes both visible light images and also infrared images. And those infrared images have told us all kinds of neat things.
Among the Martian secrets that THEMIS has revealed is the composition of Mars' many volcanoes and rocks of all kinds, which display the same range of materials found on Earth. THEMIS also has found evidence that suggests the presence of ice glaciers that may still be flowing. And after years of assembling a big picture of the red planet, Christensen and his colleagues developed another instrument that has provided a much closer look.
We built a little instrument, a miniature version of the TESS, which we very cleverly called the MINI-TESS, which we put on each of the two rovers, and we send it to the ground. And so now we have this incredible connection of Mars seen from above, looking downward, and then the same instrument down on the surface looking at individual rocks. So that complete global picture gives us this incredible context to study the planet.
As Mars research continues to move forward, ASU researchers also are involved in newly expanded efforts to explore Earth's closest neighbor.
There's been a small cadre of dedicated lunar scientists who have been studying the moon ever since Apollo days. And then in 1994, there was a small mission that orbited the moon for about 3 months, and it was called Clementine. And it acquired the first ever visible near-infrared, high-resolution imaging for the whole moon. And we learned a lot about the moon that kind of surprised us.
What Clementine and a later mission known as Lunar Prospector discovered was that the samples taken during the Apollo era do not represent all of the rocks that are found on the moon.
What these missions did is they told us, hey, look, we don't know the moon as well as we thought. There are unknown areas, very large unknown geologic provinces. And in fact, one of the really interesting discoveries, there's a big crater or basin on the far side of the moon. The laser altimeter on Clementine showed, hey, this is the biggest hole in the solar system.
But the composition of what lies at the bottom of that hole remains a mystery. To answer this and other riddles about the moon, Robinson and his colleagues are anxious to sample the surface more extensively. And the next step in doing that is a new mission, the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, or LRO, which is scheduled for launch in the fall of 2008.
Its overarching goal is to find an interesting and safe place on the moon to send humans back, but have it compelling from a scientific standpoint and an exploration standpoint, and possibly from a resource standpoint.
The LRO will have 7 instruments, including a multiple camera component that Robinson and his team are overseeing, which will be used to create a very detailed topographic map. The LRO also will allow researchers to look at the moon's geology in considerable detail, especially those areas of greatest scientific interest.
We will be, on a day-to-day basis, picking targets to take with the narrow-angle cameras, which we will have the opportunity to take about 15 or 16 pictures on every orbit, and there's 12 orbits a day. So there's about 150 sets of pictures that we can take, and that's every day for at least a year and probably 3 or 4 years.
From their facility at ASU, a team of scientists and technicians will send commands to the spacecraft, informing it when and where to take pictures. The team then will be responsible for processing all the images that are sent back from the moon.
Then we have to calibrate the image, and we have to, which means make it into a more useful format for scientists, then archive it and put it out on the web so that all of NASA can get to these pictures, because they're going to be used to plan future missions, so they want them right away. But also, as an added bonus, anybody in the world can go to the web page and download them. And we will be getting a huge amount of data.
For pioneers like Mark Robinson and Phil Christensen, venturing beyond our own planet represents the inevitable next stage of humanity's quest for new frontiers.
This is what humans are all about. They explore. To me, this is the reason to go back to the moon. This is our first step in humans exploring beyond the Earth. And we did that once in the 60s, but we stopped. So now it's time to get back to exploring the solar system with humans.
I think humans are very curious. We've run out of places to go on this planet where humans have never been before. And there's this little red dot in the sky that has volcanoes and glaciers and stuff. And, I wonder what that's like. And to me, that's what makes it so exciting, is the fact that there's something for everyone. It appeals to people on a whole lot of different levels.